I'm going to go to full view, and I think I'm going to mute everybody, but if you, and then Gabe, you can unmute yourself so you can speak.
Okay.
And then anybody else who wants to speak, who has a question or a comment or anything along the way, please feel free to unmute yourself. But the reason we mute everyone is if we don't, we, with a group this size, we almost always get some extraneous and distracting noise. So let me go ahead and I'm going to mute everybody now. And again, you all can unmute yourselves if you need to, if you want to. And Gabe, I invite you to unmute yourself right away.
Yeah, so, it's a space bar, right?
Yeah, it's good. Okay, now I'm going to do the share screen, which should bring up the, oh, there's Jonna. Hi, Jonna, we didn't have your picture before. Okay, here's the PowerPoint, and we'll share. And then I need to, I think I'm going to share computer sound, although that's not going to be a big part of it, sound. So now I'm going to go to slideshow. There we go. And I've got a panel of pictures also on. I'm just going to move them kind of to the side there. Okay. So, again, glad to have you all here to be able to talk about the visit that Gabe and I and Jonna took to Myanmar at the end of January and beginning of February of this year. First of all, I want to give you some basic information about Myanmar. It's in terms of geography, it's between 3.5 and 4 times the size of Washington State, so it's pretty sizable. And in terms of population, it has 7.2 times the population of Washington State. So it is about twice as densely populated as Washington State. Although not, you know, Washington State is all, if you look at the whole state, is not all that densely populated. So I'd say the same is true for Myanmar, although it is about twice as densely populated. In terms of economy, the average GDP per capita in Myanmar is $1,299 a year, compared to $59,532 in the USA. However, we should also look at purchasing power parity, which is kind of like GDP, but it figures in the cost of living in a particular place. And so if you look at the cost of living in Myanmar, the PPP per capita is about $5,800 per year, compared to $60,000 in the USA. Myanmar is really comparable to India in terms of wealth and prosperity. The GDP and life expectancy in India and Myanmar are just about the same. And you can see there that while in the US, the life expectancy is 78.6 years, average life expectancy is about 66.3 in Myanmar. Those are figures from 2017. One other bit of information about the country. It became independent from Britain in 1948. It was part of the British Empire. It's very closely associated with India, as you'll see when we look at the maps. A figure named Bagyok, which means major general, he was a military man, Aung San, who is the father of Aung San Suu Kyi, which many, if not all of you, have heard about. She's famous as being a political leader in Myanmar who actually was under house arrest by the military for quite a few years, but now kind of shares political power with the military. Anyway, her father, Aung San, Bagyok Aung San, led the independence movement, getting independence from Britain, and was considered the father of the nation. And he's still held in reverence for that, although he was assassinated before the independence could actually be achieved. I should mention that from the get-go, there has been civil political strife in Myanmar. And there's basically been some degree of armed conflict, civil war going on in Myanmar ever since it achieved independence. And that continues. A little more basic information. The capital of Myanmar is in one of these kind of new cities that was built to be the capital. And I'll try to point it out on one of the maps. But really the main biggest and kind of oldest main urban centers in Myanmar are Yangon, which used to be called Rangoon, and then Mandalay up farther north, kind of in the heart of Myanmar. The official language of Myanmar, which used to be called Burma, is Burmese. And but there are multiple different people groups and language groups in Myanmar, and we'll talk a little more about that presently. The Chin people, with whom they had the strongest Christian, strongest or the highest proportion of Chin that are Christian compared to other people groups. But speaking that, as I mentioned, there are multiple ethnic groups in Myanmar. Oops, I'm sorry. And then the predominant religion in Myanmar is Theravada Buddhism. That's the kind of Buddhism that is sort of typical South Asia, especially Southeast Asia. You can see, so nearly 90% of the Burmese are Buddhist. And about 6% of Burmese are Christian, although there's a very high proportion of Christians among the Chin. The majority of the Chin are Christian. And you'll see that the Chin state is up bordering India. So there's that. And the state in India that borders the Chin state in Myanmar is strongly Christian as well. And then there's a small percentage of Muslims and then other. So let's start with showing where Myanmar is in the world geographically. This is a map of Asia, all of Asia. And you can see Myanmar is down here. Here's India. India has kind of a strange geography over in this area because it's almost just connected by a thread to this northeast part of India. And it's separated by Bangladesh. And Bangladesh and Pakistan used to be East Pakistan and West Pakistan, but Bangladesh became its own independent nation, I think, in the 70s. But Bangladesh and Pakistan are predominantly Muslim. And that's really why they split off from India back in the, I think it was in the late 40s. And whereas India is predominantly Hindu. Okay, so again, and Myanmar is a pretty good sized country, a little bit larger than Thailand, larger than Vietnam and Cambodia, certainly than Malaysia. When I saw this map, I always thought Indonesia was kind of an archipelago of islands. But if you look at Indonesia, its overall surface area is pretty high, but larger than Myanmar. But Myanmar is good size. So now this is just a map of what's considered Southeast Asia. And you can see Burma or Myanmar is right, is considered part of Southeast Asia, although it's kind of over towards South Asia, India. It's sort of the transition zone between India and what at least I more traditionally have thought of as Southeast Asia down here. Myanmar is a large river valley that is surrounded by mountain ranges. And so, and here you see Rangoon or Yangon, the biggest city in Myanmar, is way down here on the delta. And then Mandalay, the second biggest, is up here, but they're in the river valley. And this large central valley is largely inhabited, populated by Burmese. Whereas these outlying areas in the mountains and jungles and so on are largely populated by non-Burmese ethnic and language groups, people groups, they're called. Here's another map showing the administrative regions in Myanmar. And I just want to point out a couple of things. Again, here's that central valley, Yangon down here, Mandalay up here. Here's the capital, Nyai Pi Thao. It's hard to pronounce. But then here's the Chin state, which borders India. Again, a part of India that is strongly, if not predominantly, Christian as opposed to Hindu. And this actually over here is Bangladesh. I hope you can see this over on the edge. And this is the Rakhine state. I'm not sure I'm pronouncing that correctly, but that you've heard about on the news that has the Rohingya Muslim population that has been kind of persecuted, I guess is the way to put it, by the military government, and many of them have been forced into exile in Bangladesh. I will comment right now and maybe a little bit more later, but the tensions, the internal tensions among the population of Myanmar are largely based on ethnic differences rather than religious differences per se. So, and more about that later as we take our walk through Yangon and see that all the major religions are represented and peacefully have a presence in Yangon. So it's not strictly religious conflict that divides the people of Myanmar. And this map is kind of interesting. It shows where there are conflict zones, armed conflict. This is from 1995 through the present, but the similar kind of thing has been going on from the very beginning of Myanmar's history. But you can see that the conflicts are all on those outlying areas. And you see a big one here in the Rakhine state. You can see a minor conflict up in the Chin state, which we were close to that. And then up here in Kachin and Shan. And anyway, it's the outlying regions where there's not the kind of cohesion and loyalty, you might say, to the central government in that central valley, the Burmese government. So that's kind of a little bit of a feel for the nature of civil conflict and tension in Myanmar. So now, for some reason, this is not working. All right, I'll do it that way. So this is another map that just shows where we did our visiting up in northern Myanmar after our initial visit in Yangon, which will mostly be focused. Well, anyway, we'll talk about the visit to Yangon soon. But after we had been visiting in Yangon for a few days, we flew up to Kalemio, which is still in the Sagaing state, but is right on the border of the Chin state. Anyway, that's where we were. So that'll show you where we were on the map. So traveling there, Gabe and I left Seattle sometime about maybe 8 in the evening on a Tuesday, I believe it was.
It was about midnight.
Oh, was it midnight? Okay. Yeah. And so we got into Hong Kong the next day plus one, because we crossed the date line. So we got into Hong Kong on Thursday morning. I don't know, 9 or 10 in the morning, but we had a 14-hour layover in the Hong Kong airport. This was, again, was right at the end of January. Interestingly, almost all of the Asians in the airport were wearing masks at the time, and very few of the European types like Gabe and me were wearing masks at this time. Anyway, after our long layover in the airport, we flew out at about midnight again, Hong Kong time. But since we were still heading west, we picked up hours. And so we landed in Yangon at about midnight. It was 2 or 3 time zones over. And here's Mr. Tui, who is the taxi driver who helped us. You can see you can't see it that well here, but he's wearing the traditional kind of long skirt that men often wear in Myanmar called the longji. There's Mr. Tui and Gabe. Mr. Tui helped us find the ATM to do some money exchange, where I got something like 100,000 chat, which sounds like a lot of money, except that there's 1,500 chat per dollar. Mr. Tui then drove us to the Summit Park View Hotel, where we checked in a little after midnight. The taxi fare was 6,000 chat, which sounds like a lot, but it was really about $4, US dollars. So we, of course, Gabe and I were beyond tired, and our biological clocks were completely scrambled. So we pretty much went to bed as soon as we got into our room there at the Summit View. But the next morning, I kind of perversely woke up early and got to see a sunrise on, this is a horrible picture, but it helps with the Summit View, or the Park View Summit, or whatever it is. Anyway, looks over the large Central Park in Yangon. And you can see there this dominant feature in the skyline is the Shwe Dagon Pagoda, the central tower, the stupa of the Shwe Dagon Pagoda, which we visited the next day, and I'll show you pictures of that. If I remember right, Gabe was telling me he either saw or heard monkeys in this park, just wild. Is that right, Gabe?
I thought I heard that. I was corrected later. There are no monkeys in that area. So whatever it wasn't monkeys.
Okay.
I think it was just dogs.
Needless to say, there were exotic birds and anyway, tropical flora. Okay. So we kind of woke up and went down and had the breakfast, kind of the buffet breakfast, which is a mix of more local food and some Western type of food. And then wanting to kind of pass some time and get adapted to the time zone, we were going to meet Jana. This was Friday. We were going to meet her that afternoon, so we had some time to pass. So we decided to go visit the Bagyok Ang Song Market in Yangon. And you see here the food court there. I'm trying to get this. I wish I could make the pictures, the Zoom pictures disappear. Oh, I did, just did. All right, great. Anyway, this is the food court there. The bunch of people. Here's lots of clothing and cloth for sale. Shoes, all kinds of shoes to choose from. And then a lady offered to sell us some jackfruit, and Gabe, being an adventurous guy who I think was familiar with jackfruit, fruit, bought it. So go ahead and comment, Gabe.
I don't know, just saw a lady making it, and I like jackfruit, so I wanted to get some jackfruit and share with Steve and be like, here. And so we later sat down. Steve had a couple pieces. And then I ate the rest because I'm can be a little bit of a piggy like that when it comes to fruit. So and it's, well, it has a bit of a interesting kind of a chewy texture, and kind of close to, have you ever heard of the stinky fruit? That's also for some reason it's escaping my
durian.
Mind.
Durian?
Huh? Yeah.
Durian.
Yes, yeah. Durian. It has but it's not nearly as pungent, but it's a sweet, a very sweet kind of flavor to it.
So there was a little more of a dynamic to that experience. The jackfruit itself is a great big thing. It's about the size of a pineapple that's got a skin, and then you break it open and pull these little pips or whatever you call them, sections out. And the lady who offered it to Gabe just pulled it out and with her bare hands, you know, pulled out all these things. And I'm kind of thinking, there's this COVID going around and we, anyway, I had some qualms about kind of a sanitary risk, but Gabe was unfazed. And as Gabe mentioned, I did eat a couple of sections and it was good and interesting, just as Gabe said. Although I will say, and I don't know if this has anything to do with this, that and Gabe, forgive me if this is too much information, but I think Gabe had a little bit of GI symptomatology for the next few days, and who knows where that came from.
It did. But anyway, it was fun. Until a day, the Sunday following. So,
okay,
I'm not quite sure it was this.
Okay,
just a general change of scenery, stomach bacteria that can happen to people.
Yeah. Anyway, the jackfruit was a good experience, and I would love to have some more. So this is still in the market, and you see the young people there in the pink robes. These are young monks in training, and we saw them in and out through the market, and they were going, and that's a little pail there. They were going around collecting alms from the merchants, and which starts to introduce the topic of Buddhism, which again is, of course, the predominant religion in Myanmar. And Jana had suggested to us a book to read. I think it's called A Very Short Introduction to Buddhism. And I was able to read that during our travels, and it was really, really helpful in kind of understanding Buddhism. It's devotion, Buddhist devotion, I think, is on a par with Christian devotion. Buddhism is somewhat complicated, I'll say, but a large part of it is striving for a way of life, an experience, a spiritual experience that transcends our worldly existence, to a large extent attained through meditation. But another really large part of Buddhism is kind of a morality, and it has to do with living right, and kind of the idea that living right kind of puts you closer to God, I'll just say, or closer to that transcendent experience. It's very interesting that about 10% of the adult male population in Myanmar are Buddhist monks, which is really was quite striking to me. Also very interesting was the merchants seemed quite willing to make donations. I mean, it was like, this is what we do. It's kind of like us giving offerings in church. There didn't seem to be any reluctance. And of course, giving alms is one of the ways that you can kind of improve your spiritual state of being. So there's a little more of a works ethic there. I think it's very sincere, the idea that living right, having compassion for others, is very important. Anyway, after we had walked through the market and seen our fill, we decided to venture out into the wider neighborhood and walk around a bit. And so we did that. And here's just outside the market. Here's a little place on the street, a kind of a makeshift cafe out on the sidewalk. And you see there's same thing on the other side, but it was the sunny side of the street. And people were staying more in the shade. And I would say, but you know, we were there in the dead of winter for Myanmar, which put the daily high temperatures in the mid to upper 80s. And this was about, you know, late morning or close to midday. And it was probably into the 80s, definitely, and muggy. So anyway, we walked around. Here's a dental clinic. Could have gotten some dental care there. And you see the apartments up above. Old Yangon. Here's a pharmacy where you could buy a number of prescription medications that I recognize for all kinds of things, including the antibiotics that we had acquired before going there, but other stuff too. And here's a medical clinic right there on the sidewalk in Yangon. Kind of an interesting look to it. And here's a chemical shop that caught Gabe's attention, and I'll let him comment. This is his picture. And
so, yeah, kind of being in the chemical world and having my degree in there, I was kind of struck by an open shop that has a lot of chemical glassware, because you don't really see that in the United States. And this isn't the only one that I saw, but kind of, I don't know, it caught my interest, and then started to figure out exactly what was going on. And it's more or less catered towards the drug and not your pharmaceutical industries, but your more towards producing methamphetamine at home. So it's a pretty kind of striking capture of how prominent the drug usage as well as drug supplying plays a role within the culture and economy of Myanmar. They have outlawed it or outlawed the sale and production of it. I don't know too much about the specific rules, because obviously they're not stopping the supply of supplies. We also kind of saw the effects of, like, when the former drug dealers went legit and started putting their money into real estate. There's a lot of new real estate investments and real estate growth that is actually shockingly pretty nice. It's not quite U.S. standards, but it's more than livable. I could be very happy and very comfortable living in some of these newer real estate developments. So that's all I got to say.
Okay. So drug trafficking is a big issue in Myanmar, and was up in Kalamio where we went after being in Yangon. I think we've got some background noise, so I'm going to mute everybody again. And then Gabe, you'll have to unmute yourself. And again, if anybody wants to speak, you just unmute yourself. So, okay, there we go. Okay. All right. So onward. So these are some beggars outside of a mosque in downtown Yangon. This was Friday, which is kind of like Sunday in Islam, the main day to go to the mosque and pray. And these were guys going in to pray. I mean, I took this picture from the sidewalk. So And here's a picture of the mosque right down there in the middle of downtown. So again, Islam per se is not persecuted in Myanmar, but up in the Rakhine state, it's the ethnic tensions which kind of are probably associated with Islam or being Muslim that is the problem. Here we're walking a little further, you know, just down a narrow street with apartments and you know, seemingly haywire wiring, but you know, I guess it makes everything work. So crowded city street. Here's a Hindu temple also right in the neighborhood, and a little bit of a close-up. It's said that there are 330 million gods in Hinduism, and a good portion of them seem to be depicted at this temple. That's the population of the U.S. For comparison, I think the current population of the U.S. is close to 330 million. Anyway, that's a feature of Hinduism. And lo and behold, right downtown, here's an Anglican church. You know, there's religious toleration there, in at least in Yangon. And then right across the street from this church is, and what we've been seeing is this glitzy mall, which was quite a contrast. Obviously, there are enough clientele, probably mostly middle class and above, to keep a place like this open. It was, you know, Gabe and I had been walking around for a few hours, and it was warm, and it was really nice to go inside the air conditioning and have a cool drink and sit down for a while. After that, though, we caught a taxi for a somewhat interesting, adventurous ride back to our hotel. It turned out our taxi driver didn't really know where the hotel was, and we had to do a few corrections along the way. But here's a street crew working on street repairs, and you'll see that there's a lot of men around and not a lot of equipment, and they're using hand tools. So it's just different there. Also, I'll comment, Gabe, and correct me if I'm wrong, but if as I recall, the cars in Myanmar have a right wheel drive. In other words, like the British, they have the steering wheel on the right side, but they drive on the left side of the street like we, no
they drive on the right.
Pardon me?
They drive on the right side of the road like we do, and they have the right hand or right side configuration.
Yes.
British does. So it's pretty interesting.
Yes. Anyway, if anyone's ever tried to drive in the UK, that's kind of a challenge. But driving here in Myanmar, I could imagine you could get really confused. But we let the taxi drivers do the driving. Dave and I had to do some of the navigating to get us back to the hotel, though. So we did meet Jana that evening. And the next day, Jana had planned this visit to the Yangon Presbyterian Church in Yangon. And here is Pastor Maka, and then two elders, Nema and Kappa. Wonderful, welcoming Presbyterians in Yangon. Showed us about their church, very inspiring. Here is their sanctuary. They have two services every Sunday, one in Burmese and one in Chin, because as I mentioned before, the Chin population is predominantly Christian, and even down in Yangon, there are a number of Chin, and so enough to warrant having a service, a separate service in the Chin language. The church is up a rather steep and imposing stairway, and this is actually looking down the stairway. There's a shot of Gabe coming down the stairway. And so you can imagine the, and this is the church up here on the third level. There's no elevator. You have to walk up and walk down that stairway. So that would be an impediment for many elderly people. But anyway, that's where their church is and that's where they meet. So after our visit there, you know, I could go on a long time, and I can't, though, because we don't have enough time. But Pastor Maka and Elders Nema and Kappa started to give us an orientation about Christianity in Myanmar and the Presbyterian Church. The Yangon Presbyterian Church is part of PCM, Presbyterian Church of Myanmar, which is the main kind of organizing Presbyterian organization in Myanmar. Is comparable to PCUSA here. Anyway, they gave us a lot of introduction about the Chin state and how there are more Christians up there. And the Presbyterian Church of Yangon is almost sort of an outpost down in the southern part of the country, not quite that isolated. I think maybe we heard, and Jonna, maybe you might remember, or Gabe, I think there were two or three Presbyterian churches in Yangon. Anyway, so after our visit at the church, we walked over to a restaurant. Yangon Presbyterian is set in the kind of in, very close to or in the heart of the administrative and embassy districts of Yangon. This is the main high court building. It's like our Supreme Court there in Yangon, even though the political capital is in a town, as I mentioned, farther up in the Central Valley. A lot of the government functions still happen in Yangon, especially diplomatic functions. Embassies tend to be in Yangon, which is where, you know, the business centers and so on are, as opposed to strictly the capital up north. Anyway, after a really pleasant lunch, we drove about over an hour, maybe an hour and a half, out to the outskirts of Yangon to visit the Ananda Mita, which means agape, children's home out there. This is one of the main missions of the Yangon Presbyterian Church. And I should comment that, and again, maybe Gabe or Jonna can help me. I'm trying to remember, but a large proportion of Yangon Presbyterian Church's budget is devoted to mission. And the number I'm remembering is about 40%. And one of their main missions is maintaining this children's home outside of Yangon, which we'll see more about what they do. But the children that they take in are children, not necessarily orphans, although they would take orphans, but children who for one reason or another are not really wanted by their family. For example, if there's been a divorce, a step parent may not be that interested in having the children of the former parent in their house. But anyway, there's a need for homes for children who are either don't have a family or not really wanted in the family home. So this is the picture.
A lot of that has to do with drug addiction or someone going to prison for dealing drugs. Sometimes when
yes, thank you. Yes, for social problems too. Yes, exactly. Thank you, Jonna. This is the main staff of the children's home. I think this man and woman are married, and I'm not quite sure whether he's part of their family or what, but this is the staff. Posted in the main kind of the family room are a lot of pictures of former residents. They take great pride in not only giving the children a place to live, but also supporting them in their education, and we'll see also in religious education. And, you know, they're showing off certificates for some academic prize winners. This is the residence in 2009, just a picture of them. So this has been in operation for over 10 years. I can't remember exactly when it was founded. But currently they house 14 children. Here's a picture with eight of those 14, I think it's eight, along with Elder Nema. And I'll tell you more about Mr. Nyotian later. Here's the girls' dorm room. Here's the boys, and notice the mosquito netting. Here's the kitchen. Sorry about the quality of some of these photos. I was pretty much shooting on the run. They consume 100 kilos. They're 14 kids, and there's a staff. Consume 100 kilos of rice every month. That's 220 pounds. So they eat a lot of rice. Here's Pastor, or no, Elder Nema explaining to us his dreams and hopes for expanding and improving the children's home. Elder Nema was a really interesting guy. He's a diamond merchant, and I take it that he probably was more wealthy than the average resident of Yangon. He actually owned a car that that one of the two cars we took out to the children's home to visit. But Elder Nema is just really passionate about this particular mission, and about spreading the word. I mean, that's part of his passion is evangelism. It was very impressive. Anyway, this is just a picture of the front yard. There's the clothesline and some, I think maybe some fruit trees and who knows what. So that's and then Mr. Nyotian, interesting guy. He was a former Buddhist monk who converted to Christianity, and I think he lives at the children's home. He's a member of the Yangon Presbyterian Church. And he also evangelizes in that neighborhood. Now I thought I wanted, somewhere I was going to say that all the residents of the children's home every Sunday travel the 1.5 hours downtown to Yangon Presbyterian Church and attend a service and then Bible study and fellowship and then travel an hour and a half back to the children's home. Now we visited them on Saturday, so that was going to happen the next day. Okay. So we still had a little bit of the afternoon left after that visit, and we got a ride back to Yangon, and I think we then took a taxi. But anyway, we had enough time to go visit the Shwe Dagon Pagoda, which is really, I think, it was definitely worth visiting, and I think it's worth sharing with the group here just to get a feel for Buddhism in Myanmar. We got there in the late afternoons, kind of setting sun, and this complex is just immense, as you'll see. Everybody needs to be barefoot there, and that includes us. So we left our shoes and socks at the entrance. Everyone is there is barefoot. I think it has religious significance, but has to do with purification and there's interesting art there. This, of course, must be a depiction of the Buddha. There seems to be a military theme to this. I really don't understand the story behind it, but it caught my eye.
It's out of Hindu mythology that he is among a battle between the Hindu gods of good and evil.
Ah.
And he protects, one of the goddesses protects him from when he's trying to reach nirvana.
Wonderful. Thank you, Jana. Again, just giving you a little bit of an idea of the magnitude of this pagoda, and all lots of gilt, the GILT, gilding. and it's kind of interesting. I visited one other big pagoda in Xi'an, China, which was more kind of like a college campus or something. And I mean, it had some magnificent buildings, but this is almost like a theme park or something. It's really interesting. But lots of people there, lots of devotion. Here's just a little detail up close. And here's one of the birth month purification stations. They have one for every month of the year, which I think is 12 in their calendar. And so if you were born in a certain month, the month that's represented here, you could come in and perform purification rituals here. And it seems to do with having, have to do with pouring water over some of these figures in a fountain and otherwise just expressing some devotion. Interestingly, it seemed like it was all women who were in the purification stations. Here's another one. And then there are also places for prayer. And for whatever reason, I don't know if this is a coincidence, but it looks like these are all men praying. And here's just a place where a Buddhist monk was meditating next to a Buddhist shrine. Here's another purification station. Again, just walking around the pagoda is really quite something. Here's a statue of a reclining Buddha, very, very typical of the representation of Buddha in the Theravada tradition, almost always reclining, kind of a feminine look, blissful. Anyway, that's Southeast Asian Buddhism. Again, just walking through the pagoda, you can see it just goes on and on. It's really an amazing place. Everybody's barefoot. And I think, you know, the large majority of people there are there out of a sense of religious devotion. They're not, maybe a little bit of sightseeing too, but I think the religious part of it is really a big part of it. Here's a monk praying. So we're getting close to the end of the hour. We're getting close to the end of the hour, and this is a good stopping point, because on Sunday, we flew up north to Kalamio, and maybe we'll wait until next week to talk about that part of the trip. There's a lot up there, but maybe we can cover it all in one session next week. So I'm going to stop the screen sharing. And everyone who wants to comment or ask questions, please feel free to unmute yourself. I know I've been talking a whole lot, but you know, I'm so excited to share this story. But I'd love to hear from others, anyone who has questions or comments, and particularly Gabe and Jonna, if you want to add anything. And you're going to have to unmute yourself, because this Zoom has this funny thing where it's really easy for me as the host to mute everybody, but I can't unmute you all. You have to do it yourself.
And by touching the space bar, you can
unmute. Yeah, you can do it by touching the space bar, or if you you can also do it by going to the right place on your screen, at least on most PCs.
I'd like to hear Gabe's impression and his how he's reflecting on the trip, how he's feeling.
It's for me, there's a sense of reminding myself that, you know, there's a lot of people in the world that have it a lot worse than I do, I have like little gripes over being stuck in traffic or things like that. And just kind of being overall reminded of that. And there's also that the sense it's kind of weird to say, I'm a bit envious of the devotion that they have there, the Christians and the Presbyterians have there, because they don't, they don't get distracted by the many things that that can distract us here. I mean, it's kind of, there's something to be said for having a simpler life. Granted, there it's not by so much by choice, whereas here you have the kind of movements going on where people are, I guess, kind of living like, you know, kind of going like a troglodyte. And so it's definitely, it's different to see. But there's also kind of a level of hope that I'd like seeing that I was fully prepared. Like, we did see quite a bit of poverty, but there's also a lot of growth and people getting out of poverty. Definitely it's a slow progress, but it's not nearly at the level that I was expecting. And granted, we only saw two cities. We didn't go too much into the central valleys and the hillsides. We only saw Calimiu and Yangon. But what we saw there was a lot of economic development happening. That's like, fortunately, we were blessed to have really decent accommodations. So for better or worse, from a faith standpoint, there wasn't too much adjusting to, you know, toilet situations. Primarily would be the one that I was most concerned about. Talking with Rebecca quite a bit, and she is kind of like, oh, you're gonna have to squat down and you're gonna have to use a floor toilet. And I was like, haha, didn't have to, you know. So some of the pictures I shared with her, like, immediately when I got in the hotel, I took a picture of the toilet. I was like, look, we're doing a mission trip in we're doing a, what's it, like, which, yeah, the mission trip in style. So, but yeah, that's I don't know, some of the bigger picture reflections that I had, and as well as some being well aware of the ethnic strifes, and some genocides that are occurring there, kind of helps put things in perspective that, like, everywhere, like, there are a lot of issues when it comes to ethnic issues everywhere in the world, and some places are much worse. So there's some things to be thankful that, like, hey, we're not, the problems that we have here suck, but it could be a lot worse. And there's a long ways to go from what we have here to what is currently happening in Myanmar. And at some level, you just, and since we're only there for a week, we haven't established a long-term relationship, and it's kind of tough to get a grip on asking the locals what is happening, because it's kind of, we just don't have that long-term trust built up, and that's not something that people are going to be open to just immediately sharing with outsiders, because they don't know what, if they could get in trouble for it, or we're trying to help them. But a guy that we met later that we'll share more about next week, a guy named Austin, he's been there for quite a while, and he shared some stories that were pretty horrendous, but and that was a very brief story. But and then after we got back, John has shared a movie with us about the Free Burma Rangers that I invited. We thought it'd be a good idea to invite you all to go see. And some of you I know were able to make it and got a good picture of what was actually happening in Myanmar. That is, yeah, pretty heartbreaking. So, but yeah, there's just a lot of thankfulness, and taking a full picture of the things that I do have here, and have in my life currently that I need to remind myself, you know, on a daily basis, not to take for granted.
Thank you, Gabe. And I think Gabe will have a lot more to share next week when we talk about our visit in Kalamio. I'd also